This article is in response to a Supreme Court opinion that was handed down. The Supreme Court handed down this past May, probably one of the more important decisions the Supreme Court handed down this year. And it involved Proposition 12, which is a law enacted here in California regarding the sale of whole pork meat in the state. And the basics of it, without getting into too much detail, is that whole pork meat sold in California has to be from pigs that were born of sows that were given sufficient room to move around in their pen. So it's basically an animal welfare law ensuring that any whole pork meat in California that is sold was raised according to certain humane conditions. What's interesting is that although almost 15% of the pork meat consumed in the United States is consumed by Californians, almost none of that meat is raised in California. 99.9% of pork farmers in the United States exist in other states, states like Iowa, North Carolina, and Arkansas. So, a coalition of out-of-state pork farmers challenged the law on the ground that it was effectively regulating behavior that was taking place outside the state of California, which California, they said, constitutionally lacked the power to regulate. So they raised a claim under the Dormant Commerce Clause of the Constitution, arguing that it violated that clause for two reasons. One, that it regulated extraterritorially, regulating conduct outside the state. And secondly, because it imposed too much of a burden on interstate commerce, which the Constitution of the United States generally protects. The Dormant Commerce Clause in prior decisions of the Supreme Court was construed as doing two important things that are relevant to this case and this article. One, in a series of three or four opinions, the Supreme Court had said that state laws that effectively control conduct occurring in other states, at least if it's commercial conduct, violate the Dormant Commerce Clause. These were laws generally that regarded pricing and tied prices that vendors could charge within the state to prices they were charging in another state. And the Supreme Court invalidated all of those laws on the ground that they were effectively regulating behavior that was going on in other states. And this created what people had referred to as an extraterritoriality doctrine under the Dormant Commerce Clause. And that was one of the arguments that the pork producers raised, that California had run afoul of that rule in enacting Proposition 12. The other strand of Supreme Court precedent that was important here were a series of decisions that are basically, they go back about a century, at least to the 1940s, where the Supreme Court has said, even if a law doesn't regulate outside the state, and even if it doesn't discriminate, that is, treat disadvantageously commerce that crosses state lines, states are not allowed to pass laws that impose costs on interstate businesses that are, quote unquote, undue. That is, they create an undue burden on interstate commerce. And the Supreme Court had created a test. It's known as the Pike balancing test because it comes from this case called Pike versus Bruce Church, where they said an undue burden is a burden that is clearly excessive in comparison to the benefits that the law produces to the enacting state. So those were the two strands of Dormant Commerce Clause decisions the court had previously decided that were important and relevant to this case. The bottom line, the most important thing, is that it allowed Proposition 12 to go into effect and said that it did not violate the Dormant Commerce Clause. The court was unanimous on the point that it was not extraterritorial. The whole point of the argument that the producers had made was not that California was actually trying to regulate conduct that was physically occurring outside of California. They couldn't really make that argument because all it formally regulated were sales that occur within the state of California. But they said it practically did. The practical effect was to alter the behavior of pork farmers in terms of changing the dimensions of their pens for their sows in states like Iowa and North Carolina, et cetera. The Supreme Court said, nope, that is not illegal. In fact, almost every state law within any federal system, whether it's in the United States or part of the European Union or what have you, any law within a given jurisdiction is going to have ripple effects that go beyond that jurisdiction. That can't possibly be the test for what makes a law impermissibly extraterritorial. Instead, that whole doctrine concerns laws that directly regulate behavior that's occurring in another state, outside the enacting state. Court was unanimous on that point, and that was very helpful because it cleared away a lot of misunderstandings and confusion that lower courts had had and commentators had had for several years. The second part of the case, which is a little more complicated with respect to undue burdens, the court was pretty evenly split. 5-4, the Supreme Court said that it did not impose, Proposition 12 did not impose an undue burden on interstate commerce, at least on the facts that had been alleged by the producers in their complaint. But here it gets a little dicey because they could not agree on a single rationale. There were 5 votes to say that there was not an undue burden. 4 of them said there was no undue burden because there was no burden at all, at least that is cognizable under the Dormant Commerce Clause. 1 justice, Justice Barrett, said that it was not an undue burden because the nature of the costs and the benefits couldn't be compared to one another. They were incommensurable because California's interest was a moral interest in the welfare of animals. The costs were dollars and cents to the pork producers. It's impossible for a court to weigh those against one another unless it's improperly acting like a legislature. And therefore, it couldn't, their claim couldn't work on that ground. So you have in total 5 votes to say no undue burden, but there were no 5 votes for any particular reason that it didn't impose an undue burden. I think the most important things that actually come out of the decision in terms of their consequences are, first, the Supreme Court clarified the so-called territoriality principle in 2 important ways. 1, again, practical effects alone that extend beyond a state's boundaries do not make a state law impermissibly extraterritorial. They couldn't, because otherwise almost every state law would be impermissible because almost every state law has some impact, practical impact beyond the state's borders. But secondly, as a conceptual matter in terms of understanding our Constitution, the court suggested and might have even stated clearly that a state laws, that this Constitution's ban on extraterritorial state laws does not come from the Dormant Commerce Clause. It has nothing in particular to do with commerce. It is just a basic structural feature of our federal system that every state is limited in some way in its jurisdiction to passing laws that have to do with its own territory. Now, there's still a great deal of uncertainty about exactly what those boundaries are as to when a law becomes impermissibly extraterritorial. But what's important from this case is that it doesn't have to do with the Dormant Commerce Clause. So just to bring up an example, if a law were to regulate something completely unrelated to commercial activity in another state, if California were to regulate, say, the possession of guns in New York, that would be unconstitutional. It would be impermissibly extraterritorial, even though it has absolutely nothing to do with commerce. And the court sort of gets at this by describing the extraterritoriality principle in ways that have nothing to do with the Dormant Commerce Clause. So that's one really important, I think, consequence of what the court decided in this case. The other really important thing is, even though in this case, the undue burden claim failed, 6 justices reaffirmed their commitment to the pike balancing test and the idea that non-discriminatory state laws can still impose an undue burden on interstate commerce. There was a strong belief going into this case that the Supreme Court was going to overrule that entire line of precedent that was almost a century old and say there's no such thing as pike balancing under the Constitution. 3 justices basically said that, but 6 other justices stepped up to say, no, pike balancing remains a part of the Dormant Commerce Clause, and it has its full scope. Nothing changes in that regard. And so that was a bit of a surprise that the court actually affirmatively retained this aspect of the Dormant Commerce Clause, despite some pretty withering criticism from some originalist members of the Supreme Court. In many respects, maybe the most interesting thing about this case is what the court studiously avoided saying. That is, we are currently in the midst in this country of a huge debate about abortion in light of the Supreme Court's overruling of Roe versus Wade a year ago in a case called Dobbs. And there's a whole lot of uncertainty about the degree to which states can regulate the behavior of individuals who are their own citizens when they travel outside of a state, or they can regulate the behavior of other people outside the state that has immediate effects inside the state. So an example of the former is a woman who is a citizen of a state leaves that state in order to obtain an abortion in another state where abortion is legal. The example of the latter being regulation of a physician who's prescribing medication, abortion, medicine into the state, delivering it into the state for an individual who's a resident of the state. So both of these examples, and we can think of lots of other examples outside the abortion context, raise this question of to what degree do states have the authority to regulate conduct that occurs physically in other states when that conduct has an impact on the enacting state in some way, an impact on its citizens, an impact on other things that are going on, causes some sort of harm within the enacting state. The Supreme Court was clearly aware of this issue, of these sort of different issues and their complexity, and it danced around them and was very careful in its language to make sure it didn't say anything that decided those issues going forward, because the court knows that those are big questions that we'll get to it eventually, and it didn't want to say anything to bias those decisions going forward. Another really important issue that the court didn't address, related but distinct, is to what degree can states use their authority, use their powers as lawmakers to try to influence behavior in other states? So one way of looking at what California was trying to do in Proposition 12 was it had nothing to do with what happened in California and the sales necessarily in California. It was an attempt to use California's market power to change behavior throughout the entire United States. Economists have referred to this as the California effect. California is such a large market that it can do things to change its market conditions in a way that actually changes the law effectively, practically, for the entire country. And a very important question the court has never spoken to is whether it's legitimate for a state to try to do that, to use its power to try to influence and change behavior that is currently perfectly legal in other states, and in order to conform that behavior to that state's sort of sense of moral righteousness. And there's a good argument that states shouldn't have the authority to do that, because in our federal system, each state is supposed to respect the authority of other states to make laws for what happens within their borders. Again, the court was clearly aware of this question and clearly wrote its opinion in order to avoid answering that question. And I think all of these questions, I mean, it's pretty remarkable. We're 235 years into the country's history. Federalism is a bedrock of our system of government here, and yet here we stand without clear answers to any of these questions. But I think given the fervor with which these issues, particularly around abortion, are being fought, they're likely to end up at the Supreme Court pretty soon.